I don't know if it was a good idea or a bad idea to have me on this panel, being a non-European, and probably for that reason, among others, knowing far less about Europe than you, each of you know. I therefore look at Europe from outside. As part of the world, Europe is part of the world, and the Eurozone within Europe is part of Europe but part of the world. Now, therefore, I think that we have to start from the global frame before moving into the European and infra-European, the whole Eurozone aspects of the crisis. Now, what I'm going to say in a telegraphic world way, and probably I apologize for those who happen to have read some of the things I have written, it will not be new. Point one, the capitalist system has entered a new stage, qualitatively different from what it was had been before. That is, in a short period between 1975 and 1990, 15 years, the centralization of the control, not property, of capital has moved up and changed qualitatively from the various patterns of monopoly capital, which is not new, which had already 150 years history behind, to a new stage which ought to be qualified. In that new stage, what is qualitatively new is that monopoly capital is controlling everything. That is that there are no more economic activities which are relatively autonomous from that control. That is qualitatively new, and that is what has created the conditions for that pattern of management of not only the economy but also the politics and the society exclusively by monopoly capital without concessions and without historical compromises with other social forces, including capitalist forces. That is, and therefore I derive from this analysis of the change that capitalism at the present stage cannot be but what it is. It cannot be, we cannot move, go back to what it was before and dream of what it was before. We have to look into beyond it, which means that there is no answer to moving out of the crisis without starting moving out of the logic of capitalism, which calls for much audacity from the radical left to have strategies, develop strategies, which look beyond moving out of the crisis. And that goes at all levels, from global to the national or even the local levels, and the European as well as the European countries, members of the European Union and some others also. That is point two or point three. The next point is that this system is imploding out of its internal contradictions, which have two facets, at least, many facets, but two at least. One is the facet of being a social struggles, and I would call them class struggles, moving up everywhere in the world, north, south, east, west, everywhere. And second, international struggles, that is struggles among the ruling classes that are the partners in that globalized monopoly, I call it generalized monopoly capital to qualify it as different from the previous stages of monopoly capital. And we have the two. This implosion is reflected in the growing conflict. I say conflict, not only contradiction, conflict between the nucleus of the triad, historical imperialism, North America, Europe, and Japan, and some of the emerging countries to various degrees, and China number one, the growing conflict, which is which is the reason for the war strategy chosen by the triad and its leader, the US, particularly with the Middle East, but not only that region. And we should therefore see it at those two levels. The fourth point comes to Europe. To my vision of Europe, Europe does not exist. There is a European set of institutions, but there is no legitimacy, popular legitimacy of a Europe. Popular legitimacy doesn't move beyond the frames of national states. And therefore democracy and the struggles, the democratic struggles, and the class struggles developed within those, even if they interfere, of course, they are not independent, in fact, but they have no legitimacy at that level. That is a major problem. Now, this system is imploding precisely for the reason which Bernard in his question indicated. That is, there is a total non-democratic pattern of organization of Europe, an enemy of democracy. Europe is the enemy of democracy. I don't know if we can dream of another Europe. We can always dream, and it's not necessarily bad, but how to change it without disobeying to it, at least, but disobeying not only on main minor questions such as whether it would be allowed or not to smoke in rooms, but on major questions. For instance, and I give only one instance, I want to take very seriously the victory, a number of victories, and I'm indicating those in Europe because I could indicate elsewhere also, the victory of Hollande in France, the victory of Syriza in Greece, an immense victory, important. Taking the case of Hollande said that it is a scandal, he said that, it is a scandal that the Central Bank of Europe lends to the banks at 1% and the banks lends back to the government at 7 or 8% or so. Now, if he is courageous enough, he should say, okay, if nobody is prepared to renegotiate the status of the Central Bank, what a country like France can do? Well, it can nationalize its banks and compel them to lend to the French state at 1.2%, whatever they get from the Central Bank at 1%. How this will be received in Europe and what echo and what chaos it would create or not create, etc., etc. We can give examples of that kind. And therefore, we ought to relate the answers and the strategies answering the crisis in various countries of Europe and in Europe in the frame of the global crisis. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.